Hello everybody, this is the Database Systems Core Lecture. My name is Jens Dittrich and today we will be talking about indexing part two. So that is where we are in the agenda, how to find stuff at scale. We talked about indexing last time already, B-trees to a large extent. And today we will be talking about a different type of index called a bitmap and a variant of that that's called a Bloom filter. But before looking at that, some of you noticed, hey, Professor Dittrich is saying B-tree all the time, but if I Google for B-tree, I get a slightly different index structure. And I would like to say a few words about that. There might be confusion out there. So if you look at how I define a B-tree, that is basically an example of a B-tree, how we define it. We have two different types of structural elements, the nodes, also called internal nodes, sometimes only nodes. Those are the green ones here. So we have two levels of nodes here, the root node on top and these other three nodes in the middle. And then there are the leaves. That's the second structural element depicted in blue. And the important property we have in such a B-tree, as I called it, is the nodes don't contain any values. The nodes only contain keys, also called pivots. The pivots allow you to pick the right subtree when you search anything in that tree. That's the important thing here. And now my machine crashed again. Fantastic. Fängt ja gut an. Okay. My machine has crashed. Okay, now you should be able to hear me again. Sorry, my machine just crashed. I had a hardware issue. Christian, can you give me feedback whether you can hear me? Whatever that was. I think my graphics card is broken. Once in a while. Okay, now, so we are up and running again. Again, so we have two different types of structural elements in such a B-tree. Yeah? And we have these green ones, the internal nodes, and the blue ones are the leaves. Yeah? And that's basically how you define a B-tree. In other words, there are no values contained in those internal nodes. The internal nodes only contain those keys. Yeah? And only the leaves contain these key value entries. And if you look back at the definition we had here, when we look at the different nodes and leaves, that was also like mentioned indirectly. Yeah? So here we only have keys. That's this one. And then we have key value pairs only on the leaf level. And historically, B-trees were defined a little bit differently. Historically, defined B-trees such that the nodes could also contain values. And that was the original definition, the original proposal of a B-tree, that the B-tree also contained values. But then the B-tree evolved into different variants. They were basically named B plus tree and B star tree. That is what you should Google if you look for what I mean by B-tree, B star tree or B plus tree. But so what happens is that actually in the database world, no one is saying B plus tree or B star tree. For database people, it's always a B tree. So I won't say B tree in the following, B plus tree in the following. I always mean the B plus tree, but I say B tree because it's easier to pronounce. And I have to say it so often in the database class. Yeah. So by B tree, I mean what was historically proposed as a B plus tree. That's basically the clarification you need at this point in time. Okay, with that, let's go away from B-trees a little bit. Let's look at bitmaps. So what is the bitmap index? It's a very useful index that you can use in databases, and the situation is something like that. Assume the following table. Here's a colleagues relation. We have three attributes. Let's assume that name is a primary key. Name typically shouldn't be the primary key. You have an artificial column for that, typically an ID. But for the sake of a simple explanation, let's assume it's a key. And then what you can do is a bitmap index. It's something like that depicted on the right. What you need is in a bitmap index are so-called bit lists. So this works as follows. This is a bitmap on one of the attributes, on one of the columns, namely the city attribute. So in order to create a bitmap, I need a different bit list for each and every value that appears here in the original table. So if you look at the values, you see New York appears several times, depicted in green, then Cupertino appears twice, Berlin appears many, many times. So you only have three values. And what you do in a bit list, in a bitmap, is you create one bit list for each of these values that appear. And the semantics is, if that is the value present in the original table, you set it to one, meaning true. If not, you set it to false. You see here, whenever there's New York available in the original table, city, the bit is set. Otherwise, the bit is not set. It's zero. And the same here for Cupertino. There must be two bits set. Everything else is zero, and so forth and so forth. So that means you get more. The entire structure is called a bitmap. And these individual lists for each value, this New York, and then all of these bits, that's called a bit list. Yeah? Here's three bit lists contained in that bitmap. And that's a simple way of doing of defining a bitmap. Of course, you could also do that for other columns, but you see already this has, in terms of space, you may run into problems for situations where there are many, many different values appearing in such a column. So this is a very good structure that works well if there are repetitions. Yeah? And then the structure makes a lot of sense. Okay, here's a second bitmap created on street. Here we have four different streets. I again colored it to depict how the things belong together. Yeah, here's one bit list for Uni Street, one for Mac Street, Long Street, MS Street, and so forth. And like that, you could create that bitmap. And of course, now if you have a query and you want to have all colleagues, for instance, that live in Long Street, well, you don't have to go through that relation in the first place. What you do is you basically just scan this bit list, which in many cases is in column layout again. So if you think about data layouts, in the end, this looks like a table again. It is a table where the type of each of the columns is a bit, a single bit. That's all you need. So basically, in order to determine which of the rows of the original of the original table colleagues has that value, you just scan that column, so to say, this bit list belonging to this attribute. Yeah. So if you scan basically along those bits, you identify directly which rows qualify, and then you can look up those rows directly. Yeah. And of course, for any conjunct and disjunct on those attributes, you can basically combine the bit lists, doing a bitwise AND, bitwise OR, stuff like that, to determine directly which of the rows qualify under my WHERE clause, under the condition you're trying to evaluate. And that's why bitmaps are super useful. Yeah? So you can do basically now many, many operations on these bitmaps. You can select, as I said, you can evaluate WHERE clauses. But of course, you could also look up whether a specific value exists. Yeah? You can look up whether there are people that live in New York. For instance, assume you want to count the number of people that live in New York. You don't have to look back at the original relation. You could just count the number of bits that are set in this bit list for New York. That's it. Then you're done and everything's fine. Hmm. Yeah, those are operations that become possible. What else? Space. Well, as I said, if you do the math, you will quickly find out that this structure is sensitive to the number of different values. And today we will also look at some ways of fixing that problem for certain domains at least. Yeah? But assume you had millions of different values occurring in such a column, yeah, then you would have to have a separate bit list for each and every value that appears in such a column. Yeah? And so that's a problem. Yeah? So again, low cardinality columns with few values appearing, that's a good candidate for such a bit list. Yeah, just summary, of what I just said. So for where clauses with ands and ors, that's a great thing to consider. It's a building block for query processing. And in particular, that's something to keep in mind when considering whether you use a bitmap or not. As you may already have seen, this is a column layout. And for column layout, we learned that, hey, column layouts don't work so well if there are many insert operations, right? If there are delete operations, because then you have to maintain all of these bitmaps. So if you insert any row in the original, let's go back maybe here, to show that effect, assume you inserted a row right after Olaf, for instance. Yeah, then you would have to adjust all of those bits in all of the bitmaps you ever created. So the maintenance effort, the effort for keeping those indexes up to date, is not so great in bitmaps when there are many insert and delete operations. There are always ways around that and how to fix that. But in general, keep in mind that for those indexes, they typically pay off super well if it's a read-mostly workload. Meaning most of the operations are read operations. Even an update operation is typically not such a big issue. Of course, for instance, consider the situation. This guy now moves from Berlin to New York. Yeah, it's a matter of changing two bits. That's cheap, right? You change this bit to zero. Now, where are we? So this guy moves to New York, so we have to change this bit to true and this bit to false. Everything fine. That's all you ever need to make that happen. Okay, but if you insert a row or if you delete a row, then there's much more work you have to do. Okay. And when it comes to space, there are some fixes that are available. One idea is the so-called decomposed bitmap. So how does that work? Let's assume we have the following situation. Let's assume we again have a city column, but it was already dictionary compressed. So here you only have an ID that maps to some sort of dictionary. In that dictionary, you can look up, 653 is whatever, Saarbrücken, 42 is New York, and 7 is London or whatever. Doesn't matter, we have numbers here. And if you create a bitmap on that, it's clear you have three different values. You have to create a bitmap like that. Yeah? So three different bit lists in that bitmap are contained. And the problem now occurs, of course, the more cities you enter, because as I said, you will have to add another bit list. Yeah? More and more bit lists have to be entered for that. And here's a little trick I played. Actually, I could only keep that up till the last row having an entry for that. Yeah. So here you see they have different lengths, the different bit lists. That's something you could do. That's legal, actually, because what that actually means for this bit list, for instance, for 653 is, okay, everything that follows is zero implicitly. It must be zero. There can't be any element that's set to true anymore. That's one way of storing that if you wish. But you could also make sure that all of the same lengths doesn't matter. Semantically, it's the same thing. Now, the idea of a decomposed bitmap is like in the how you represent our numbers in the decimal system is to say, well, a 6 is basically composed of a 600, a 50, and a 3. We just add them up, and that's a 653. So basically, now for each digit, you make an extra block of 10 bit lists. That's what I'm doing here. So that's basically the hundreds, the tens, and the ones. And then within such a row, you have to set one of the blocks saying, okay, this is a 6. Yeah, the 6 is set to true, which means 6 times 100. Yeah, that's that you have to add up. And here you set 5 times 10. That's what you add up. And here it's 3 times 1. That's what you add up. So 600 plus 50 plus 3 is 653. Here we go. Yeah. And then depending on the number of distinct values in such a column, this may actually pay off. This may be cheaper to store than having a separate bit list for each and every value that appears, because now you can decompose the number and have less storage space that you require here. So that's called a decomposed bitmap. You can also do the standard bitmap operations, of course, as in standard bitmaps. Yeah, equality is, for instance, relatively clear. Then you just don't it's not enough to look up a single bit list. You have to look up multiple bit lists to make these things happen. But basically, many things work as before. Yeah, I think I'll jump over that. I said something about space comparison. Another way to encode bitmaps is so-called range-encoded bitmaps. How would that work? So if you remember, that is what we had so far. Assume the following situation. We have the year of birth in one of the columns, and we have one bit list for each of the appearing values again. So relatively big bitmap. And now what we could do alternatively is to say we range encoded. So basically the semantics change. If you go back, that was the original bitmap. And if you look at the top right here, you see the semantics of a single bit in every bit list is the value equal. That's what I explained so far. So basically what this bit list is saying, is the value equal than the one in the header here? Is this value equal 1982? If so, then yes, set it to true. Otherwise, set it to zero. So it's only equality that's modeled by this bitmap. And of course, you could change that semantics to say, yeah, that's why this changes on the next slide. Here I'm saying, is the value smaller equal? Yeah, can be equal, but also smaller. And then of course, you have to set many more bits here. For instance, here, that this one, this true, symbolizes that 1981 is smaller 1982. Yeah, it is, so it's true. Yeah. So basically, how you do that is for each existing value in attribute A, and for each row ID is basically an identifier of such a row. So we discussed that multiple times when looking at data layouts. So when I explained data layouts, I said, okay, imagine it's an array. Yeah? Basically, if you have 10 different rows, assume it's an array from 0 to 9, and the index into the array allows you to directly access any element within the array. Standard array index access. A similar concept exists in databases that's called a row ID. Basically, it's an identifier allowing you to jump directly to any row. Yeah? So basically, what this line is saying for each existing row in that relation, we now basically check whether that specific cell we are indexing. So in this case, A is, do you have a next slide explaining it? No. For this specific attribute we're indexing, so this is A, in this case, that's the year of birth. For this specific row ID, check whether it's smaller than the value. And if that's the case, you set the bitmap to true. That's again, just a pseudocode description of what I just explained semantically on top here. So it's basically smaller equal, you check for every cell whether the value in the original table is smaller equal the value that you write on top of the bit list. Yeah, that's the value you're checking against. And if that's the case, well, yeah, then it's set to true. Well, there's one observation that you might have at this point in time. So if you think about this thing, what could you do with this? Are there any things to simplify that? Is there something that jumps to your mind without looking ahead in the slides, of course? But is there something you might feel like, okay, we could do here? Maybe you write it in Discord. Lecture channel, text channel. Any idea? Okay, someone writes run length encoding. Yes. Yeah, so if you have bitmaps, in particular, if you look at the uncompressed bitmaps, I mean, let's go back, that's an interesting point. You will see that they're very sparse. Yeah, very few of those bits are set. It depends, of course, on the number of bit lists you have and the number of rows. But in general, bit lists are a great candidate for run length encoding, obviously. Yeah, that's a good idea. Mm-hmm. There's a second one proposing that. So one of my PhD students is answering in the lecture channel, Marcel, go away. You're not allowed. Or you have the same name. the PhD students shouldn't answer those questions. Those are for the other students. Okay. Now, what I was up to was to say, okay, basically, we can drop the bit list with max value 1987, right? If this is the highest bit list, and if this is the semantics, I'm in the wrong column here, no? No, here, small a, I'm in the right column. I was in the right column. So if this is the highest bit list, yeah, 1987 is the highest value, and you want to model this, these semantics, is the value smaller equal? Well, implicitly, all of the values in that column are smaller equal than the highest value, right? So what information would that bit list yield, right? Because if someone is writing it, we can ignore columns containing only one. And that is basically this bit list with the highest value appearing in that column. That's exactly this bit list we can leave away. And therefore, in a range-encoded bitmap, boom, you can do it like that. It has exactly the same information. We didn't lose any information because the highest column, the highest bit list is always, all bits are set to true. Yeah, that's one thing. And then basically what you can now do is you can do range encoded operations. Yeah, as you know, you don't get only equality by those operations, but you can now check whether the value is small or equal. With that, you can basically map ranges to those bit lists. So basically the boundaries of the two ranges can now be used to look up those specific values. I don't know, should we do an example for that? Maybe do an example for that. Switch on my iPad. Okay, how do we do that? We could say, give me all values where the value is in between 1982 and 1984. Let's do it like that. Yeah, so we want to have 1982, 1984. So which kind of bitmap operation would that be? Does someone have an idea? And if so, write it in the Discord. Why doesn't the iPad show up? So iPad writing doesn't... The iPad doesn't show up, I don't know why. I don't know why the iPad doesn't show up, it's strange. Now we're getting somewhere. Now you can see it. Okay, that's what we're looking at. So someone is proposing 1984 XOR 1981. 1984 XOR 1981. So why would that be an idea? Why would that work? Any proposals? So for us, the bitmap for 1984. I look at this column, I get everything that's smaller equal. So this already gives me the half open interval, everything up to including 1984, right? That's basically minus infinity, oops, that's supposed to be an infinity, sorry for that, till 1984, right? Including 1984. If I look up this one, that's everything smaller equal 1981. Yeah, so basically this gives me the interval minus infinity 1981, including. But I'm not interested in this stuff. I'm interested in, well, the 1984 starting from 1982. So basically I have to remove everything till 1981, right? And removing here basically is saying I remove it everything where the bit is set already in this bit list, yeah, because those are the values that are smaller equal 1981. Yeah, so it mustn't be the case that this bit is set. Yeah? And that, so what you're proposing is it's either set in, so the exosemantics is now basically giving me that it's set in the 1984 column and in the 1981 column, you set it to zero. Yeah, if both are set, XOR gives you zero, which means that the value is on the left side, is basically here in this left interval. Yeah, that's left, if you maybe make the value would be here. Yeah? For the other cases that it is set in 1984, but not in 1981, that means it must be in the interval, so that's correct. If it's set in the interval 1981 and the interval 1984, you would also set it. Right, so does anyone see a problem with that? So is that the correct way of doing that? Should I explain again? Okay. Maybe I make it a new one, right? So we look at So look at the interval 1982 from that is what we're interested in. So basically, but we only have the possibility, we can't look it up in the standard bitmap. Now, what you could do is, because it's an integer domain, you could make an individual lookup. You could look up in a standard bitmap, you could look up 1982, the bit list for 1982, the bit list for 1983, and the bit list for 1984. Those are the bits you would look up. Then you OR them together. It's a big disjunct, and then all the bits that are set with that. Basically, you do, if a bit is set in 1982, or a 1983 bit list, or a 1984 bit list. Those are the rows where there's one of those values. It gets nasty if it's a float type, but here we have an integer type, so you could translate it into three different lookups for the three different bit lists in that case, okay? Now we don't have the semantics anymore. We have this range encoded bit lists and bitmap, and what that means is here we have a different semantic. We have the semantic, is the value smaller or equal? So if I look up an individual bit list, I don't get that information whether the value is equal. I get the information whether the value is smaller or equal. Okay. So if I make a lookup, what one of you suggested to say, maybe let's start the other way around. It's easier to write. If I look up bit list 1981, the information I get is that those are the values where the value is smaller equal 81. Yeah? Maybe you can also make it in terms of the example, you know, which are the rows that have 82, 83 and 84. Those are these ones, 82, 83, 84, a very nice example. They're all in the same cluster here. And here's another one. So those are the four rows qualifying. So if you look up this bit list, yeah, basically you get the bits that are set are the ones for the values that are 1981 or smaller. So in other words, those are rows you are not interested in. That's not in your interest, okay? So basically it translates, we can write it down, bits set for non-qualifying rows. Non-qualifying rows, huh? Because it's 1981, 1980, 1979, blah, 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 but you're only interested in 1982. So what you're getting is the stuff you're not interested in on the left side of this interval, that stuff basically that sits here in this direction, that basically the lookup to the bit list 1981 is giving you. Now, if you look up 1984, as suggested, what do you get? You get all the rows where the bit is set to 1984 and smaller. Yeah, 1984 and smaller equal 1984. So basically, you can now remove the other bits from that information, because here in this bit list, yeah, what happened? Oh, I switched to black. Doesn't make too much sense. So in this bit list, you now get all the bits, I write it down again, all bits set for qualifying rows plus the ones on the left, plus the 1981 and smaller rows. Yeah, so it's a superset what we're retrieving here, but we have to remove some of those bits, and that we do by the XOR operation, that we say, okay, if both bits are set, it actually means that the value is smaller equal 1981, then I make it a zero. That is what the XOR is doing. But if only one of the bits are set, then this works in this situation, because if one of the bits are set, it means it must be exactly in this range here, or if it were in that range here, but not in the other range for 1984, that's not possible by the construction of this decomposed bitmap, huh? Because if it's set in the 1981 bit list, it must be set in the 1984 bit list. Huh? And therefore this comparison works. Huh? That's one way of translating this structure. Okay, so with that we get to another, so as I said, you can compress these things effectively. Bit lists can be compressed effectively, but there are other ways to make use of bit lists without requiring a bit list that is of that length. Huh? So, and that's called a Bloom filter. And the idea here is to have a structure, a so-called probabilistic data structure that has the following property. If you query that structure and the element is available, it is guaranteed to say yes. But if it's not available, it may go either way. It may be yes, it's there. It may say no, it's not there. So if it's there, you definitely get a yes, you won't get a no, which would make the algorithm incorrect. So if you go back to that again, here's the example. And the idea of that is basically, now you also have a bit list, but the bit list may be smaller than your actual data. It's a bit like in a standard hash table. If you remember hash tables from algorithm and data structures course, then you remember that the hash table is, you try to make it smaller than the key domain you're actually mapping from. Yeah, if you have 1 million elements, and you want to put them in a hash table typically. Let me phrase it differently. If you have a key domain of 1 million values, but you only have 100,000 values in that domain you want to store, you don't allocate an array of lengths 1 million, but you try to allocate something smaller, but map it in that smaller space through a hash function. Yeah, so basically, the idea of a hash function is always to squeeze elements that are distributed over a relatively wide domain into a smaller domain. Yes, and that's the same idea here in such a Bloom filter. And how this works is, how we insert an element is we need a couple of hash functions for that to make it happen. And basically the hash functions, as in the standard hash map, map to one particular slot. If the value computed by the hash function is larger than the number of buckets, you do a modal operation. So I already assume here that the hash functions only create values in the domain from 0 to m minus 1. Okay? And with that, I create a couple of hash functions here, h1 through h3. And then when I want to insert something into this Bloom filter, I do the following. So I have here a sample value, a sample key I want to insert, 42, 43, 42. So I put it into the first hash function. This may yield slot number 12, which means I set the bit to true. I do the same for the second hash function, which yields 7, set slot 7 to true. Hash function 3 sets, okay, slot 32, I set that one to true. So at most I will set 3 bits to true in this scenario. And what's the next slide? Okay. And if I insert another element, you will again put that element into those hash functions. Yeah, that may create a different triple of slot 30, 17, and 19. You set those to true. And of course, it might be that you now also try to set a bit that was already set by a previous insert operation. And so forth. So now if you insert, for instance, here another element, 1, 2, 7, 8, 1, again, put it into those hash functions, and then you are in this situation. This bit was already set by a previous operation, by a previous insert operation. So that was this one, so where we hashed into slot 30 by inserting that element already. And now you're trying to set that to true again, and of course that information is lost. The caller is just here on my slide. In the actual data structure, that caller is gone. Yeah? So basically, you just set that. You try to set it to true again, but it doesn't make any difference, yeah? Because it is already true. But that's the main idea of such a Bloom filter, yeah? Setting the different bits to true according to a couple of hash functions that you define. And how you define the hash functions is a different story. That's a separate thread, like in standard hash tables. What is a good hash function? There are many, many ideas for that. Typically, Murmur hash or stuff like that has very good properties. But here, the crucial decision is the number of hash functions. And in terms of performance, of course, you could think about, okay, what does that cost me? How expensive is it to run an element through 3 hash functions? So if what you're storing is on disk or SSD anyway, it won't make a big difference. But for a main memory system, that may already be something that you feel in terms of overhead. So. Okay. But then, now, if you look up such a Bloom filter, basically what you do is you do the same thing. If you look up an example for that, maybe that's a good example here. So now assume we look up a value, we want to find out whether this key exists. So we do the same thing like in an insert. Basically, we run that value through the 3 hash functions, and now you can also do that iteratively. You run it through the first hash function. You see, oh, that bit is set to true. Then you continue, run it through the second hash function. You see that bit is also true. You run it through the third hash function. You see that's also true. So all 3 bits are true, which means the element may be in that bloop filter. There's no guarantee that it is there, but it may be. And that is, if we go back to this slide again, you will see those are the semantics of such a bloom filter. So if for one of the hash functions I'm looking up, and that's, here it was three, but I can define that. If one of that is zero, meaning false, then it cannot be in the bitmap because a bit must have been set before. Now, as I explained to you, the insert operation, if you inserted it before, and whenever you insert, you can only flip bits from zero to one. You can never flip back bits from one to zero through inserts. That's not possible. So it must have been set if it was inserted. But if you now look it up and see, no, there one of those three hash functions I'm looking up is not true, then that implies that it cannot be there in that bit in that bloom filter. Yeah? So the key cannot be in the bitmap. However, and that's the probabilistic nature of this structure, is if you look up these different hash functions, as I just did that, and all of them are set to true, that means it can be. It doesn't have to be. There's no guarantee. And why is there no guarantee? Do we have a case for that? Because, I mean, what may happen is that the bits are, I think we didn't insert 743. I think that's my slide on that, right? Yeah, that's an example here that's trying to symbolize that. So basically, that is the situation. So we look up 7431. However, I never inserted it. But what the hash functions, all of those hash functions, could now point to slots that are already true. Those, they may be true due to some other insert. There's no guarantee that those slots were set to true by this specific insert on 7431. So there's a certain randomness here, and it may actually happen, you look it up, all of those bits are set to true, but again, those bits were set to true maybe by some other, by other inserts, and that, so therefore this doesn't imply that the element is available. It's just a precondition. It's a precondition. If it's available, all of those bits must be set to true. If one of them is zero, it's guaranteed it's not contained in that bloom filter. If all of them are true, well, then we have to check back. And maybe it's there, maybe it's not. So this is this kind of structure is also called a filtering index or filter index, in the sense it doesn't give you the precise set of values. It doesn't make you a guarantee. It doesn't tell you, yeah, the value is there. It just tells you it may be there. And in many cases, it helps you to answer the question, yeah, it's not there. I guarantee it's not there. That is what this structure is really useful in, to say, no, it's not there. Forget about it. It's not there. It's not there. It's not there. Not there. But sometimes it says, yeah, it may be there. I'm not sure. You better look it up. Yeah? So it pre-filters. It basically helps you to avoid work, expensive work you might do to look it up in the actual table or on another expensive index. It's pre-filtering the rows that may qualify. Yeah? Not telling you the precise set of rows that qualify, but the ones that may be really interesting. Okay, with that, I would say we go in the break and we see you 11 past one again. See you soon. Okay, with that, let's continue. Just one clarification, because some other, some of you proposed for this example, we had in the decomposed bitmap, in the range encoded bitmap. Here we go. I think we have the iPads. Okay, so here. So one way would be to use the XOR here, and that only works due to the special semantics. But the other, maybe more natural way of doing that, I also just wrote it in the Discord channel, is to say, well, I need the bits from the ones in this range, right? And that I get by looking up this bit list, 1984 and smaller, minus the bits that are set to the left of this. So 1981, basically, 1981 and smaller. That's basically the stuff I need to remove here. And of course, that are the bits, exactly the bits you retrieve by looking up this bit list 1981. So basically, you can replace the entire thing also by saying 1984 and not 1981. Yeah, that's a more natural way of doing that. Okay. So with that, let's continue with the Bloom filter. So one of you asked that why is it that we use multiple hash functions? And that's something you also look at in the exercises today. And that is basically the situation I just showed you. So it's looking up a value, and the Bloom filter tells you, yes, it may be there. That's called a false positive. A false positive in the sense it's actually not there, but the index claims that it may be there. That's called a false positive. And so depending on the number of hash functions you pick for such a Bloom filter, you can compute the expected false positive rate. So certain assumptions that go into that, like all these hash functions distribute the inserts uniformly over the data space, stuff like that. You will look at that in the exercise today. So we have an exercise about that. But basically, what it boils down to is something like that. So here on the x-axis, you have the number of elements being inserted. And then on the y-axis, you have the false positive probability. So the probability that the Bloom filter tells you, yeah, it may be there, where in fact it isn't there. And that's actually something you want to optimize. You want to have a very low false positive rate to make sure that the claim that it may be there and it's not there, so a false positive, will only happen very, very few times in comparison to the others. Yeah, so basically, you try to use this probabilistic data structure very close to a precise data structure. Yeah, you try to reduce the amount of false positives. And that you can tweak by adding more hash functions, because the more hash functions you add, the more unlikely it becomes that you run into the situation that bits are set, even though they're you never inserted that specific element. And that's basically the curves you get when you do something like that. And we will do that in the exercise today. You should play a little bit with the different probabilities that are available here for these index structures. And you can also, based on that, compute the optimal number of hash functions for a specific number of elements being inserted. And as I said to you, there's obviously the trade-off. If for each and every element you call these many hash functions, that's computational overhead. I mean, there are huge differences in between these hash functions, how expensive it is to compute a hash. If you have a simple modal operation that costs like close to nothing, but if it's more complex, even a murmur hash or a cryptographic hash function, you could also use cryptographic hash functions for these structures. You shouldn't do it, but you could do it, because the values produced by these functions have very good properties. They're very well distributed over the domain. but they are too expensive. Yeah? So it's not only the individual cost of a single hash function call, it's the cost of such a hash function call times the number of calls. And if you increase the number of calls arbitrarily, yeah, you might decrease the false positive rate, but yeah, then you may have a computational problem. Okay, so that's a summary for bitmaps and bloom filters. Both are very useful techniques to evaluate where conditions, in particular in read-mostly scenarios. Keep that in mind. Under many inserts and deletes, that might not pay off. It's hard to say when exactly, where's that trade-off, where it will pay off, but there is a cutoff, and it depends on the workload as usual. But the rule of thumb is read mostly is fine. If you have many inserts and deletes, it's not so easy to keep these structures. Bitmaps are space efficient and can additionally be compressed. Yeah, we talked about compression in the context of data layouts. And when we talked about that, we only compressed the data, the relations. Yeah? But of course, you can also compress stuff that looks like relations, but actually it's an index, yeah? A bitmap. If you go back, well, we had that before. Well, that looks like a table, right? You can compress that. And some of you suggested run length encoding. Yes, that's a great idea. You could do that. But other methods may also apply there. Also specialized compression algorithms that work well on that. And one thing to consider, and maybe we have time to look back at that when we talk at query processing, is whether you decompress those compressed bitmaps while doing query processing. So you could in fact do query processing on the compressed representation of such bitmaps. And run length encoding is a great candidate because it gives you directly the next entry point into such a bit list where the next bit is set. So maybe we have some time when we look at query processing. Okay. Yeah, and the Bloom filter, that's approximate, probabilistic, but tunable for many scenarios. Again, that's not the same scenario, not the same number of hash functions for each and every scenario. The more you are I/O bound, the more hash functions you can afford. If it's more on the, if it's a main memory system, you probably don't, you cannot allow for too many hash functions, but that's something you have to calibrate in the specific situation. So this is tunable, and that's good news in the sense that you can tune it to the parameters that work best in your specific situation. Okay, with that, I would like to show you a couple of other definitions that are important in this context, and just to for you to also have it on the slides. And that is queries and point queries in general. So we will be talking about queries in the next lectures as well, but also with regard to indexing. And yeah, if you know relational algebra, you may know already this sigma. Yeah, that's basically the filter operator in the relational algebra, or the selection operator is another name for that. And basically what that does is you have an input relation. That's the input you're filtering stuff on. And then you have a predicate, that is defined on the individual entries of that relation. So it basically maps from a relational schema here in square brackets to true or false. That's called a predicate. A function that only returns true or false is called a predicate. So basically, you can use that function to input each and every tuple individually, and then for that tuple, it will tell you whether that tuple qualifies, yes or no. So here's an example. So if you have a schema that contains an attribute named zoom level, you could check whether the zoom level is 2 for the specific tuple. If that is the case, you will return true. That's basically what this means here. So if it's true, return true, otherwise it's false. So this should be interpreted as 2 equals, basically, in a programming language, equals equals 2, yeah, return true. And with that, we can define so-called equality predicates. We use them heavily already in point queries, yeah, in the B-tree point query. Basically, that's a predicate of this format. You have an attribute that's contained in this schema. So one of the attributes is called a underscore I, and then you want to check whether that attribute value is equal to a specific constant. Yeah, you want to have everything in the ID column that's equal 42 or something like that, that is called an equality predicate or point query. Yeah? We already called it like that when we talked about B-trees, but here again, the definition, how I will use that in the remainder of this lecture. And here's an example for such a point query or equality predicate. Here you say everything with a zoom level equals 2, and that's what should be returned by the selection operator. Selection operator returns itself a relation, of course. The input in relational algebra is always a relation or two relations in one operator, and the output is always a relation again. But you should know that from your undergrad lectures on databases or big data engineering. Well, and then what we looked at so far is, of course, you can compute always, you can always look at the entire relation, check each and every tuple against the predicate. That's also called brute force or scan. Yeah, you have linear complexity, linear effort to scan each and every tuple and check whether the predicate holds. And if that's the case, you add the tuple to the result set. However add is implemented, however that actually works, but conceptually, that's what you do. Or what we have now done starting last week is to use some sort of index. Yeah? So we organize the contents of the relation such that we do not have to inspect each and every tuple to determine whether a tuple belongs to the result of a query. So the idea is really to restrict the search space. Yeah, not that we don't have to go through each and every tuple, but the index is, remember the pictures of these street signs, yeah? The index is pointing you to the parts of the data that are interesting. And that may also involve that I reorganize my data such that a street sign can be set up, right? Sometimes the data first has to be sorted. We saw that in B-trees. First has to be sorted, then I can put up street signs, also called nodes. That's something, a precondition for these things. So, but what I would like to introduce in the following is a different way of understanding indexing and looking at it. And I started explaining that already two first semesters like that in our new program, Data Science and Artificial Intelligence. I use the same slides there because I think it's so fundamental and really helps you understand what an index is and what it is not. Because often in textbooks, you see that certain things are confused. I would like to give you here a vision on how to not confuse these things with the following slides. And that works as follows. So the first thing we need a couple of definitions. And that's a very actually trivial definition, but it's used frequently because it's so important. That's what we call a horizontal partition. Horizontal partition and a horizontal partitioning. So basically, what we do is we have an input relation R, and now we say that any assignment of the tuples that were originally in R into relations R1 to RK, and K can be arbitrarily chosen, typically strictly greater than 1, otherwise it doesn't make too much sense. We call that a horizontal partitioning if for all of these tuples that existed in the original relation R, that is this term, T element R, there now exists one of these RIs, yeah, one of these other relations where we will find the tuple. So in other words, we have this big relation, we split it into smaller relations, and the only condition I want to have here is that, well, if the tuple existed in the big relation, I want to make sure that it also exists in at least one of those smaller relations. So if you look at an example, that's an example of a relation having 4 tuples, very simple schema, just 2 attributes A and B. Yeah, the first attribute is an integer domain, the second is some character. 4 tuples, and now if I partition that, let's say, into 2 relations, that's how it looks like. Yeah? So this is the first relation, has those 2 tuples, those has these 2 tuples. And why is that a horizontal partitioning? Because all tuples that existed here, 2a now lives there, 7b lives there, 1b lives there, and 6c lives there. So all tuples can be found in the in R1 and R2. And of course, if I do a union on R1 and R2, I end up with R again, right? So I can do that. Here's another example. But basically, here is an example for something that's not horizontal partitioning because one of the tuples didn't make it into one of the subpartitions. So we lost one of the tuples, and that's not the idea. So in horizontal partitionings, we must make sure that all the tuples still exist in those subpartitions. That is what we call horizontal partitioning. And then we can constrain that further with regard to disjointness. Disjointness means now I take a horizontal partitioning and I make sure that whenever I intersect two of those subpartitions, the intersection is empty. Yeah? So in other words, for no tuple, none of the tuples is available in more than one of those subpartitions. Yeah? I make a decision to assign it to one of those, to exactly one of those partitions, but not to multiple of them. So here's a counterexample. This one is a horizontal partitioning because it fulfills this definition above here. That's all fine. All the tuples exist in the subpartitions, but unfortunately 2a exists both in R2 and in R1. Therefore, it's not disjoint. If I intersect R1 with R2, well, I end up with 2, a, so it's not empty. Well, that violates the definition, obviously. So those are two important definitions here. And if you talk about these partitionings, you can think about, like, hey, what's a partitioning function? How do I partition this stuff anyway? There are different ways of doing that. You could say, so basically now we're talking about our functions that map from the schema of a relation to an arbitrary domain. Let's again start with examples. So here's an example for such partitioning function mapping from R, so the domain, the schema of R, to an integer. And I say I input a tuple, and for any tuple I return its attribute value of A modulo 2. Yeah, so if I input tuple 2, a, I return 0. Now basically, this is saying whether the first attribute is odd or even. If it's 0, it's even. If it's odd, it will return 1. You should have seen that before. That would be a partitioning function. And based on that, I could create partitions. I could say, okay, this every tuple that, given this partitioning function, returns a 0, could be put into one partition, and everything returning one could be put into another partition. That would be one way of doing that. But there are many ways of creating these partitioning functions, and another would be to say, oh no, I do ABC. Yeah? So basically I just project to the second attribute value, the B attribute here, and return that by that partitioning function, and then I could also build partitions on that. I could create three partitions here, one containing A, the two B's and the other C. So I in those partitions, I don't put the return values, of course, to be precise. I would put those tuples that, given that partitioning function, return the specific value, okay? So that's the idea of a partitioning function. And with that, I can define a so-called induced horizontal partitioning. So basically now we have a partitioning function. And they, given a specific relation R, imply a specific relational partitioning. And what I do in the following is I name those partitions based on the return value of the partitioning function. So here, it's the same example as above. We return 0, 1, 1, 0. So now I create two partitions. The one is named as 0 because that is the tuples that, using that partitioning function, return 0, and this is all tuples where it returns 1, and so forth. And you have three partitions depending on the output of those partitioning functions. Yeah? So actually, all easy stuff, no surprises here, but I think it's important to write down these definitions. Yeah, and now with that, I can do recursion. Yeah? I could say, why would I only use one of those partitioning functions? I could use many of those. I could say, now I have a sequence of partitioning functions from P0 to PML. They all may map to multiple, to whatever domains. It doesn't really matter. Huh? So I can define that as I wish. And now I apply those partitioning functions one by one. We could say we apply first P0 on R. This yields a set of horizontal partitions as defined above. Yeah? So a set of partitions, yeah? Named with respect to the domain, that is the output domain, that's the target domain of this P0 partitioning function. And then I could do that iteratively, yeah? Or recursively, if you wish. I apply all these partitioning functions one by one. Yeah? And that yields a set of induced horizontal partitions. So as shown again for this running example, you can end up with something like that. Now that's called subpartition 0A, and that contains only the single tuple, yeah? Because it's even and is A. Yeah? And here this is even and C, and so forth and so forth. And of course, you could also do it the other way around. So the order of whether you first apply P0 and then P1, or first P1 and then P0, it will yield the same result, obviously, in this situation. No? So we have we have horizontal partitions, we have partitioning functions, we have induced partitionings, and we have induced recursive horizontal partitionings. And with that, we can define an index as well. We could say, well, any set of recursive or non-recursive horizontal partitioning functions that can be exploited by a query to reduce its search space is called an index or an index structure. Yeah. So the again, as I said before, more concretely, the goal of an index is to reduce a set of horizontal partitions we have to inspect to compute the result for a query. Again, here's a high-level example. Again, assume we have this induced horizontal partitioning as shown before with all of these partitioning functions I showed you before. Assume we have a query like that. Assume we want to have all the tuples where the B attribute equals C. Yeah, that's our select, our selection here. And well, now I could rewrite that query. That's basically what an index does. An index rewrites a query to a smaller subset, a subset of horizontal partitions that hopefully require less effort to search through those subsets. And that happens here because, well, if I look at those partitions, well, there's only one that has a C here in its name. So magically, my predicate in the select operator magically matches the naming of the horizontal partitions. Yeah? If you don't have a match among those two, it's not going to work. But here it works. Yeah? So I'm selecting on an attribute I previously used for partitioning the data. Yeah? And therefore, now that allows me to rewrite this query. I'm actually, that's basically user level query. Yeah? If the user says select star from R where B equals C, that's something you would see on the SQL level, translated down to relational algebra eventually. I can rewrite that internally. I could say, well, that gives me the same result as that query, right? Because I know only this partition R0, comma C may contain results. The other partitions cannot contain any results where the attribute value of B equals C. Yeah, that's the main trick we play. And here's a similar example. Assume we look for all values of A that are equal to 7. Well, again, think about we used only this partitioning function on attribute A. So if it's 7, it means, okay, the modulo must be 1, right? So if you have anything where the modulo is 0, we can just directly throw it away. We don't have to look at this one. We don't have to look at this one. But yeah, we do have to look at this R1B. Yeah? So basically, we rewrite this query to this query, and it gives the same result. It's guaranteed. Third example, A equals 8. Yeah, that's basically the opposite case. So we know we can exploit at least this partitioning function to only consider the A values that are even. Yeah? And with that, we rewrite this query to the query of the using the union of R0A, union R0C. Yeah? And that gives the same result. And yeah, maybe another thing, when you think about that, we had that when talking about this interval partitioning last time. Yeah? Basically, here, I mentioned that already, that's an interval partitioning. And you see the intervals here directly, I wrote them on the slide. Here, the intervals are implicitly defined by the split operations, yeah, whenever you change one of those pivots in such a node, yeah, they implicitly change the interval partitioning. But of course, you could also define those partitioning functions yourself and partition the data recursively, also using B-trees, by having a fixed partitioning function. Then you're in trouble if nodes overflow, I understand. But basically, the core concept, the core idea here is always the same. It's a recursive partitioning. Yeah? And many, many indexes live on that concept. So one thing that I think is really important here, and that goes mixed up in many textbooks also, is the difference between a logical or a conceptual index versus a physical index. Yeah? When I explained B-trees, I already said something like, well, you know, a node and the leaves, they correspond to a page size. Page size being whatever, 4K of bytes. It sounds pretty physical already. Yeah? Rather than saying, well, a node has whatever K outgoing, or K plus one outgoing arrows has K pivots, stuff like that. Yeah, that's more a logical description. And that's a confusion that exists in many index structures and are sometimes problematic. So what I mean by a logical or conceptual index is it provides a concept allowing us to select a suitable subset of the horizontal partitions while searching such an index. Yeah? And an example may be, yeah, you just have a partitioning function to identify the qualifying horizontal partitions, and you only inspect the partitions where you find the results. That's what I just explained. That's basically a logical index. Yeah? You have a partitioning function allowing you to identify certain partitions that contain qualifying results or may contain qualifying results. However, eventually, I mean, you can't just directly implement a partitioning function or a horizontal partition. You somehow have to make a decision, a physical decision on how to implement that. So on the left, I'm depicting the what part. On the right, I'm depicting the how. How do I do that? Yeah? So eventually, you make a decision like how to implement it. That may be a decision on a specific programming language, Python. It may be to say, okay, no, whatever, these sets or horizontal partitions, I put them in a list type. That's already a physical decision. You may say that each object is another list. You may have lists of lists. Another decision may be to say, okay, I put it in main memory. That's something physical, rather than saying there's an abstract representation of a memory, and how that memory is mapped to DRAM or disks or stuff like that is a different concern. I map it to this abstract memory. Eventually, you have to make a decision, yeah? And that makes the index more physical. Yes, you go away, you still have an index, hopefully, implementing the core ideas, the concepts, the logical concept, but as that cannot be implemented, you have to make decisions on the physical axis. That is what happens. So here's an example again, how that looks like. So here, what I did is I have a partitioning function, again, this P0 function, but now I changed it to a function where I don't do modulo 2 necessarily, but modulo m. So I can adjust m as I wish. Basically, that's what remains when you divide. Yeah? So now if I divide these numbers by 2, that gives me exactly this odd even. Yeah? So this first set where the return value of p0 is 0, that gives me the even numbers. This gives me the odd numbers. But if I set m to 3, well, it gives me this partitioning. If I set it to 5, it gives me this partitioning. And that's already conceptually a logical index. And again, I wrote it down here by saying, okay, what is conceptual and what is not conceptual? Yeah? So all of that is conceptual. But now, the more you progress implementing that, you make more and more decisions. For instance, you could say, okay, if I know it's two different sets, I could put them into some sort of array-like structure. Yeah? I say I have an array where each array points to a set of the tuples. Yeah? So basically, again, very similar to a hash index. Yeah? That's what a hash index is doing. You have certain slots, often represented as arrays, and then you have a direct access to that slot, and in the slot you keep a list of the qualifying tuples. Yeah? So that's basically what you would end up with. And that is already in hash index, and you should have seen that, and that has a zillion applications in data processing. And of course, if you say, okay, well, conceptually, I have for each of those slots a horizontal partition with a qualifying tuples, you could represent each of those horizontal partitions within a slot using a list style structure. That's what I'm depicting here. So basically, you have a pointer to the first element, pointing to the next element, pointing to some sort of null pointer or none, conceptually saying there's no other element following. This is typically how hash tables are explained, but this is already taking many, many physical decisions on how to exactly implement those index structures. And that's why I'm trying to explain it like that, telling you, well, also in hash index as well, it's just a very specific way of organizing horizontal partitions. Yeah. Okay, here's an example for trees. Yeah, that's how we, that's basically a binary search tree. You should have also seen in some undergrad class. Yeah, so you have a root node. You have two outgoing arrows. I'm calling them arrows, not pointers, because if I say pointers, it sounds already like as if it were like a programming language pointer. It doesn't have to be like that. It just has to be any means allowing me to get to the next node. Yeah? So this arrow allows me somehow to get from this node, I gave it a number 3, just an internal ID. You will see in a moment why that makes sense. So this allows me to make this pivot comparison. Yeah? I make the comparison, if it's smaller, 5, I go to the left subtree. Then you make the next comparison, if it's strictly smaller, 2, I go to the left. If it's greater equal 2, I go to the right. Yeah? This standard binary search you do in a binary tree. Yeah, but at no point in time am I telling you how these things get implemented. I'm just telling you that's a conceptual thing. And then comes the second thing, once you do a physical index, to make a decision on how nodes get implemented, how arrows get implemented, how tuples are represented, remember data layouts, on the storage device. Yeah? So I think it's very important to keep these two concepts apart. There's a logical, conceptual idea of what an index does or is supposed to be doing versus many, many design, many, many implementation decisions that are taken to be able to implement that. And the important thing is in indexing, but also in other algorithms and in all of computer science, is to keep these two things strictly apart. So my advice here is really, whenever you learn a new algorithm, a new concept in computer science, try to think about, try to step back a moment, whether what you're looking at is a purely logical concept, is it something more physical, or is it something in between where some of the ideas are actually conceptual or some of them are physical? Is there a way to get rid of the physical concepts, to just have the conceptual, to just have the concept? Yeah? And that often helps if you do it like that. So here's another example for a tree, what that may look like in practice. So if that is our logical tree index, a more physical index may take a decision to represent that in a table-style structure. So here I assigned this node ID. I made that unique in a table with 4 columns. And it could be a standard relation in a database system or whatever. I'm just saying, hey, it's a relation with 3 rows. Each row represents one of those nodes. Yeah? So basically, the nodes get represented through their IDs. So if that is node number 3, we have the pivot element, that's 5. We have here an arrow. Again, that's not necessarily a programming language pointer. It's an arrow pointing to the left child. This is a pointer pointing to the right child, the 4, right? I could look that up in that relational model and say, okay, now if I do a search, let's assume I search for whatever element 3, I compare that first with this entry, 3 smaller 5, I have to go to the, that is 9, I look up 9, and then I make a comparison again, 3 is strictly greater 2, I go to the right child. Yeah? Then the right child is actually the tuple here. I make the comparison, 3 equals 2. No, it's not, so that's not the result. This tree doesn't contain a tuple where the first attribute value is 3. Now, that's how I could do the search here. But then again, I could make a decision to say, no, that's my relation. Okay, that's table-style structure. I could represent that in a column style layout. And that's a column layout here depicted with these gaps in between the attributes. Or I could say, well, how do I actually represent those values? So I could say, well, I use 4 bits for each of those entries. 4 bits is enough in that scenario. I could say the 3 is represented by 0011, and then the 4 is represented by 0100. Oops, how can I mark that? Yeah, that is a 4. Now that's one too many. I'll mark the next 4 bits here. That is a 4, yeah, and that is a 9. And here I also color coded the entries. So that would be the 9. If you look at column left, that would be 4 bits representing, the first 4 bits represent the ID of that specific node, the left child, and this turquoise represents this tuple 6C. So that would be an even more physical decision. So you're seeing it's not only black and white. It's not only this super logical and something more physical. There's kind of a space in between. And then the interesting question is that already the most physical index or physical representation of the index you can envision, or is there more on the right side of that? That's something for you to think about, and maybe you have an idea and write it in the Discord channel. So if this is one extreme on the left, the logical channel, this is one extreme on the right, the physical channel, is that the end to the story, or is there something even more physical? Someone has an idea. Think about what we said about hardware. No one has an idea, okay? Hardware. I mean, the question is, if those are bits, I'm just saying I represented with those bit sequences. I didn't tell you how are those bits represented in my computer system. I didn't tell you which device I would use to store those bits. And then even on the device, I typically don't have direct access to how that is stored. If you think about a hard disk, there's a physical decision on which platter to use, on which cylinder, on which platter to put that those bits and on which cylinder on which disk to put it. Yeah, so those are even more physical decisions. Yeah, the more you go into the physics, there's even more. There's always another level underneath. Yeah? So saying that someone is a physical, that something is a physical index, actually means that something is more physical than something I had before. Yeah, and that's very important. Logical and physical are relative terms and lead to a lot of confusion in database systems. So here's again what I mean by that, depicted as a design continuum. Yeah? Often they are mingled together and, I don't know, mixed, these descriptions. And I think it's a good exercise to keep them apart. So there's this extreme where it's a pure concept. Yeah, the ivory tower, absolutely conceptual, that there's no physical, there's no interference with the real world. But if you implement it, you go further to the right, you increase the physicality. But what I'm trying to depict here in this part is that's not the end to it. Yeah, there's hardware, there's whatever stuff that making it more physical. That's very important. Okay. Yeah, so that's basically the summary of that, logical versus physical. These terms are confusing also in databases, not only in general computer science, but in databases in particular. The analogy you can think about is this, the big and big data. Maybe you heard it in some of my other lectures, but if not, big data is a problematic term because you don't know what big means, bigger than what. So the reference point is missing. If I say big data, what is big for you? What is big what speak for you, what speak for me. So it's a relative term where you don't mention the reference point. Yeah, what, bigger than a terabyte, a petabyte, or what? What are we talking about? So that's a problematic term, saying big data, and the same is for logical and physical. It's also with respect to a reference point, but you don't mention the reference point, and that's the root of all of this confusion. So I wrote it down again here. So be careful when you see those terms. Whoever writes it or says it has always a reference point in mind. And if in doubt, try to ask about that reference point. Okay, any questions so far? Good. So we spent kind of a couple of minutes left. So a few things I would like to mention is, and it already popped up. So what is the performance of an index? And the same holds for any other algorithm. And again, you might have seen that in theoretical computer science complexity classes. It's one way of tagging, of labeling the performance of an algorithm. But I already alluded to many others. So one is the overall runtime, of course. Others clock cycles spent. Others is I/O operations performed. Yeah, we had that at length when talking about the sequential versus random I/O properties, and that we should be careful about that. Then robustness to different workloads. So maybe my index is able to help me a lot with a specific type of query, but for others it doesn't help me at all. Yeah, so is it then a good idea to keep that index? Maybe not. I don't know. It's hard to answer in general. It always depends on the workload, the types of queries you're looking at. Adaptability to different workloads. So maybe I've seen similar types of queries for years and years and years. All of a sudden, a new query comes in. Will you still be able to answer that query efficiently? So that's, can you adapt quickly to such a changing workload? Yeah, there's read versus write performance. We looked at that today with bitmaps. Yeah, bitmaps work well if there are many read operations, but for write operations, you shouldn't have too many of those, in particular not inserts and deletes, because they may be difficult to handle. Scalability. So if the workload increases, you have more queries, you have more data, will your indexes still work? So you have a good counterexample are the binary search trees. You learned about the algorithms and data structures. Those indexes don't work well if they go to external storage. They have these small nodes that have to be mapped to an external storage medium like a hard disk, and that doesn't really work well. Now, that's one of the major, or was one of the major motivations for having these page-sized B-trees, because they map perfectly to this page unit used by storage devices. Yeah, then single versus multi-threaded performance, of course, is a concern. Yeah, 20 years ago, everything, or many things, were still single-threaded. Nowadays, everything is multi-threaded. How well does the index support these kind of things? Do you have to do locking, stuff like that, concurrency control? And memory consumption, of course. Yeah? So you could also argue that with today's main memories, it's not often a concern, but it may be a concern as well. Yeah, if you don't care about that and your memory is full, well, then you have a problem. Then you may have to do I/O operations that are costly. So maybe it's better to have a smaller index, because then you might be able to do everything in main memory still. Yeah, those are the performance dimensions. And there are only three different approaches that you can do to analyze performance of an index, but any other algorithm as well. And I'd like to recommend this book. If you don't know it yet, it's from 1991, but still great. It's from Ray Jane, The Art of Computer Systems Performance Analysis. And it basically makes a claim that there are only three classes of techniques to analyze the performance of a system. So the first is analytical modeling. Basically, some sort of mathematical model that can be complexity classes, for instance, but could also be more fine granular, a cost model. Yeah? A cost model that gives you a prediction like, that's going to take 42 milliseconds, what you're up to do. Yeah? That's called a cost model, really a performance model that gives you a precise number, maybe wrong, but it gives you a number, maybe even uncertainty range with on how long it's going to take. The other is simulation, so that's a runnable model focusing on the major effects of a problem. Yeah? So you're not, you try to simulate certain parts of an aspect, maybe you try to implement others, and in the simulation gives you some idea on what the performance may be like. And the third is an experiment. So that's a real software, hopefully running real queries and data sets. Even here, sometimes real queries and data sets are often not available. You have to kind of simulate them through benchmarks, which are hopefully representative of something in reality. Yeah? But the important thing is not to be confused and believe that any of those methods is better than the other. So all of these methods have their strengths and weaknesses, depending on what you want to do. And the best thing you can do is to always use at least two of those. Any two of those, it depends on the situation, but not only a single one. A single one may be very misleading because, for instance, assume you do a mistake in one of those and the analytical model, you believe it's X and it's not X or something like that, where in fact it's not X. That may be confusing. So basically, using two models also gives you like a backup calculation. If the two approaches give you kind of the same result, then that's a good indication of that you're on the right track. But not only use one of those. And so the big trade-off you see in this world is the following. So basically, if you look at analytical modeling, the effort is typically relatively small. You don't have to implement anything. Yeah? You just write down a couple of formulas, and then you're done. And typically, those models are relatively abstract. Basically, here using the English saying the "down to earth" in the sense we're not really down to earth here. We're far away from earth. It's very abstract. We just see this little blue disk there. It's even hard to understand that we're looking at a planet here, right? It's so far away. However, these analytical models generalize very well. That's what I'm trying to depict here by this area. I'm not claiming that this is a linear relationship. I'm just saying the degree of generalizability for these analytical models is super high. If you look at the other extreme, let's look at experiments first. Here, the effort for doing an experiment is typically super high. You have to really implement all of it. You have to get real data sets. You have to get real hardware. You better don't make a mistake. You do functional testing. You do performance testing, and so forth, and so forth. That's a lot of effort. And you're very down to earth, also in the sense of overfitting to a specific machine, overfitting to a specific implementation. Yeah. So someone implemented that stuff, and maybe that person wasn't that proficient in that programming language. If you had given it to a different person, maybe it would be two or three times faster. You never know. It's very hard to find out. Yeah? So that is why experiments often lack certain generalizability, because the results you observe from an experiment depend on so many things, on the hardware, on the programming language, on whoever implemented it. Maybe you did some bugs in the implementation. Maybe you took wrong turns while implementing that. Many, many things. So you have to be really careful with interpreting that. So those are the two extremes, experiment and analytical modeling. Simulation is like in the middle. Yeah, it's like a compromise among the two. But again, I'm not saying that one of those methods is better than the other. All have their use cases, and it's sometimes not easy to pick. Typically, what we do in my group is we're very much oriented towards experimentation. So we implement stuff, we implement algorithms, indexes, but also anti-systems, which may be very hard, and that's a lot of effort. But in the back of our heads, we always have some sort of analytical model. So we try to, hey, does it make sense what we're doing? Is that really the complexity class you would be assuming? Why do we see an experimental results like that? Can we explain each and every bit in that graph you're seeing? And then rarely we also run simulations. Most of the time it's experiments plus some sense making in terms of analytical models. Does this stuff make any sense we are seeing here? Okay, so with that, I think time's up. We have some other slides, but maybe we can talk about those slides later. So that's it. for today. The assignment sheet will appear soon. I will be available in the Discord lecture break audio channel if you have any questions. See you on Friday for our lab, 12:15, and the lecture next Wednesday, also 12:15 again. Stay safe. See you then. Bye-bye.